Could I ask Professor Hazim Shah to address the audience?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When I first knew that I would be engaged in a conference on academic imperialism, I was thinking of a working definition of academic imperialism, but I didn't get around to producing one or looking up for one because I thought some others would have given the definition, but unfortunately none has, and I myself do not have an sort of adequate definition of it, but I take the concept of academic imperialism as meaning the world of scholarship is in which there is a dominance by a certain group, basically related to the West, over the rest. And of course, one can debate as to whether such a phenomenon really exists, or whether the imperialism that is meant is something which is deliberate and intended, as in political imperialism, or whether it is an unintended consequence of a long process of historical development. I think perhaps there's a bit of both. And one perhaps cannot equate academic imperialism with political imperialism, although when one looks at the relationship between power and knowledge, perhaps there is some sort of relationship, although the nature of the relationship has got to be made clear. Now, when I heard what Professor Reza was saying about science, the meaning of science, and how some people do not understand the meaning of science and the need for us to fight imperialism, if one can speak of fighting imperialism, by doing good science, i.e. playing the game according to the rules set by the West, I began to think of its relationship between, in terms of what we have discussed yesterday, in terms of the relationship between the natural sciences and the social sciences and humanities. And even before this, I have thought about the distinction between the two and its relationship to our discussion on academic imperialism. And I'm of the opinion that the problem is more acute in the social sciences and humanities as opposed to the natural sciences. I've looked up some data in terms of science and technology indicators in the OIC countries, and as Professor Reza has rightly pointed out, Iran's publications, scientific publications, as recorded in ISI journals, is indeed substantial and has increased, in fact, perhaps exponentially over the years. And Iran is now perhaps second to Turkey amongst the OIC countries in terms of scientific publication. Yeah? So in terms of the natural sciences, I think Iran is doing quite well in the international arena. But what I'm more concerned with here is not with the natural sciences as such, but with the social sciences and the humanities. I think this is where the problem of imperialism is more serious. And I would like to divide my talk into four sections, which is basically number one, on the impact of colonization on local thought and knowledge. Number two, on critical responses by non-Western scholars, such as the Malaysian sociologist, Professor Syed Hussein Alatas, who is the father of Syed Farid. Syed Hussein is now no longer with us. He died a couple of years back. His son, Syed Farid Alatas, is now holding the post of head of the Malay Studies Department in National University of Singapore and carrying out his father's tradition of critical scholarship on the West. And also another critical response by Edward Said in his famous books, Orientalism and Culture and Imperialism. And I will also be mentioning some of their critical responses towards colonialism and imperialism in the literature on the social sciences and humanities. And thirdly, if I have the time, I will speak on practical or pragmatic matters on constraints to publication, which is to do with imperialism in a practical sense. And number four, also if I have the time, I'll try and say something about possible recommendations for the future on how to deal with the situation. Again, let me go back to my first point, that is the impact of colonization on local thought and knowledge and the marginalization and displacement of local knowledge. Academic imperialism, whatever that might mean, I believe has its roots in the history of colonization. Because when the colonial powers took over the nations which they conquered or annexed, they introduced to these countries, to these nations, a whole set of changes, institutional changes, and changes in knowledge production and so on and so forth. And these institutions which were introduced are mainly institutions such as administrative, legal, and economic institutions. So they rule the country, and they bring in Western forms of administrations and institutions, which is left behind as a legacy for us to continue. Now, these institutions needed, as its support, the establishment of educational institutions in order to support the machinery which they have set up. So initially, the kind of educational establishments which were set up was basically technical in nature. For example, in Malaysia, we have agricultural college, technical institutes, and so on, to cater for employment of workers at the lower and middle levels, and only later that they provide university education for the higher level kind of skills. But together with these kinds of technical knowledge also comes other forms of knowledge brought by the colonizers. In the case of Malaysia, it's the British, through institutions such as university, and it is here that we have subjects such as history, anthropology, sociology, and in the case of Malaysia, we have Malay studies, Indian studies, and Chinese studies being introduced. Now, I think it is in this second area that the kind of imperialism that I'm interested in and that we should look at further. Yeah? Because one of the negative things about this kind, this introduction of these new kinds of knowledge, which displaces the old kinds of knowledge. Yeah? For example, history, yeah? The notion of history itself, the kind of history produced in Western scholarship is different from local history, which is considered as mythical by the British, for example, or semi-mythical. Yeah? So, and other forms of knowledge, for example, ethnobotany was already present in local societies, but then the British came in and introduced the Linnaean system built on the work of Carl Linnaeus of classification and introduced Latin terms and so on, which were alien to the local tradition. So with the introduction of these new kinds of knowledge, local knowledge tends to be displaced and marginalized. Yeah? But these new kinds of knowledge are perpetuated in the colonized countries through the education of the elites. So the elites, in order to gain access to positions of power, in order to have social mobility, have to acquire Western education in order to fill up the top jobs and so on, and in the process acquire Western modes of learning and thinking and so on, without realizing that this knowledge was a product of Western civilization. History, economics, anthropology, sociology was a product of the Enlightenment. So, and so was science and technology and so on. Although, of course, one realizes that science has its roots in the medieval past also, which includes Islamic civilization. Now, therefore, the context in which these kinds of knowledge developed was alien to the local traditions and local thought. And it was a product of the Enlightenment with their own secularized modes of thinking and so on and so forth, but which had been effectively associated with what we would call the hard power. So we tend to think that the hard power goes together with the soft power. that the ability of the West to control nature correlates with the ability to understand human societies through sociology, anthropology, and so on. So we begin to accept these new forms of knowledge uncritically, and even accept their conceptualization and their portrayal of ourselves through the knowledge of sociology, anthropology, and so on. In the case of Malaysia, the work was done partly by colonial administrators, like Frank Swettenham and others, who were not only colonial administrators, but wrote books and articles and so on the Malays. And as a result of this kind of self-definition of the Malays' image, of the image of local societies, local indigenous people in South Asia and so on, there has developed this Oriental scholarship, this Orientalism, which is perpetuated through the universities and so on. And in the case of Malaysia, I would like to draw your attention to the work of the Malaysian sociologist, Syed Hussein Alatas, who reacted against this form of imperialism in knowledge production. And Syed Hussein Alatas wrote books such as The Myth of the Lazy Native and The Role of Intellectuals in Developing Societies. And these works were cited by Edward Said in his books, Orientalism and Culture and Imperialism. And in fact, Said was partly inspired by the attempts made by people like Syed Hussein Alatas. And in the book, The Myth of the Lazy Native, Syed Hussein Alatas debunked the colonial image of the Malays and other South Asian natives as being lazy, as being people who are not interested in developing themselves, in developing the societies, and so on. And Syed Hussein Alatas pointed out that this image was perpetrated by the West in order to justify colonialism, because if the local natives are lazy, they're not interested in working, they're not interested in industry, therefore it is only right that other people come in and develop the land and the society. And Syed Hussein Alatas pointed out that it is not true, because the Malay farmer wakes up early in the morning for his subuh prayers, 5 o'clock perhaps, or 5:30, and then work in the paddy fields, from morning till evening, whereas the colonial officer would have a good time at the bar and so on after 4 or 5 o'clock. So who is the lazy guy? So these kinds of images were challenged by Syed Hussein Alatas, and similarly Edward Said in his book Orientalism and Empire, Culture and Imperialism, engaged in a critique of Western scholarship of the East, where he claimed that the knowledge which was produced in anthropology and history and so on was to serve Western colonial interests and power.